Welcome, and today we're going to talk about digitizing the physical world. And in essence, I want to walk you through the whole process of when we are going to collect a physical signal and everything we need to do to turn it into what we call data, which is usually where most people start with this type of conversation. So really, we can break it down into six steps. Essentially, we've had a whole lecture on converting a physical signal into an electrical signal. And this is with devices that we call sensors and transducers and different types of things. And there's a whole discussion on all the different types of sensors, different types of things that we convert it to be able to understand the world around us. The next five phases are what we're going to talk about in this lecture. One, we want to understand the signal so that we can understand how we need to acquire it. Then we need to be able to do the proper filtering so that we can acquire it properly and not have artifacts in the signal. Then we want to be able to scale it so that we can fit it into our digital system. And that could be in two directions. We could have to amplify it, make it bigger, or we could have to de-amplify it, make it smaller. So those are two different things. And then we need to convert the signal once we have it in the right size and the right format to actually convert it into data. And then how good that data is dependent upon things like resolution sampling rate, which we'll talk about. Once we have it in there, then what we may need to do is actually what we call rescale the data or scale the data so that it's calibrated to the units of what we are intending to measure in the first place, instead of voltage or instead of current, which are the typical things. And then there's also software scaling. So that's essentially what we're going to talk about today. First off, let's talk about understanding the signal. Understanding the signal is when we consider signals and this is in electromagnetism. The way we think of signals are waves, and the way we model them is with a wave equation. So if we look at a basic sinusoidal signal wave equation, we can look at the value at time t, whatever it is, it's going to be equal to the peak amplitude, so that's a naught, so that's the amplitude for a specific signal, from the baseline to the peak or baseline to the valley, either way, versus peak to peak, which goes where you subtract between both of those two, times the cosine of the omega, which is the angular frequency. Now, if you see down on the bottom there, angular frequency can be converted to frequency measured in hertz. So there's two ways to go about that. And if you look at that, basically 2 pi, the frequency in hertz is equal to omega. So it's basically a rotational pattern with the 2 pi. Also, the reason oftentimes we want to convert it into f instead of omega is that it's related then to time, which is 1/seconds, or 1/ the period, which gives us frequency. And then we can also then add what we call a shift. Now that shift could be it's called a phase shift, and it may shift forward or backwards based upon when we're starting the acquisition. And so that's what this theta is, the shift in the sine wave, which shifts the whole curve left to right. So that gives us in essence, a baseline for when we're going to acquire signals. There's a fundamental assumption that we kind of have an understanding of this waveform. Now, this is very basic. This is assuming a sinusoidal waveform. So we make some assumptions there so that we understand where we think the center frequency is around a signal and what we think the average amplitude is, or maybe the peak amplitude is of a signal. Now, many signals are not that simple. Many signals actually have more than one frequency, and they have more than one amplitude. So in those cases, we have to draw the line of where we think the maximum frequency is, and maybe the maximum amplitude is, and use those numbers so that we can then use that when we're converting into a digital. The reason is, if you think about a signal that you want to come in, think about if you have a gate that's only this big, and you have a signal that's the size of my forearm over here. You can't get that entire signal into the gate, right? So the gate has to be sized properly enough so that the entire signal can come in. So if that's amplitude, then we gotta deal with that amplitude, unless we have to scale it down. And that's something we may have to do beforehand. So then the frequency, we get into the filtering. So this is why it's important to understand the signal. And we have a whole bunch of signals that have been studied over the decades. And I've got some biological ones, I've got some non-biological ones here, so you can get a sense of what the signal frequency ranges are and what out of the output out of the sensors that you use, what type of voltages can you get. So again, you want to know what your maximum voltages or maximum currents are that you're going to get out of the system. So like, for example, an electrocardiogram, an ECG, you're going to go anywhere from negative 10 millivolts all the way up to 100 millivolts. So that whole range is something we got to understand. And 100 millivolts is the largest scale that we're going to get, which means when we're going to acquire, we want to have something that can acquire 100 millivolts or greater. Right, you want to have a little bit of buffer, because if you don't have a buffer and you try to ram that signal in, it's going to get clipped or cut off. So that's why we want to make sure that your gate is large enough to be able to allow that signal. The other thing we have to consider is the frequency. So if you notice here, again, let's look, use electrocardiogram signal. It goes from 0.01 hertz, and this is like little f, all the way up to 250 hertz. Well, if 250 hertz is the highest frequency we expect, it could range among all of those frequencies. Again, what we'll use is the highest frequency or the maximum frequency when we design our system. That's again so we can properly filter the system. Now, it also may be that we want to cut off the lowest frequency so we don't get noise that's outside of that. In that case, it changes things when we go to filtering. And if you also notice there's the principal measurement, it may be in the same units, like volts to electrocardiogram, but it may be something completely different. So for example, if we're trying to measure an IoT humidity sensor, we really are trying to measure between 0 and 100% humidity. And then in that case, we're looking at how do we convert things. Now, here we have a rise time, and we talked about in the last lecture, of 8 seconds. Well, roughly 5 times that is about how fast it can move. And then you can convert that into the fastest frequency that it can respond as far as that. Now, typically, that's not something where you're trying to acquire really fast versus like if you're trying to acquire microwaves, you're trying to acquire those really fast because they're really high frequency already. But then you want to be able to convert those units because you're going to have something coming out of the sensor, which is probably voltage, and you're going to want to convert it back into humidity. And pretty much almost all sensors on the market and transducers come with kind of their table of what do they spit out and what does that represent as far as the actual measurement they're measuring, which is whole part and parcel to what sensor vendors do, is they give you all that information so that you can then reconvert those things. And it's really dependent upon the sensor type, dependent upon how it's excited, what it spits out, all those kinds of things. So again, these are all different things that you want to be looking at. The other thing to keep note is, and we mentioned this before, there are such things as passive sensors. Transducers are always active, but sensors can be passive. But that's kind of the exception, not the rule, such as an electrocardiogram where you're having, you know, a patch that converts bioelectricity to electricity. All right, so let's talk about this filtering. Now, the filtering is important for us to understand where the frequency is. And again, we have to look at the highest frequency, because that's what's going to tell us where we need to put our cutoff. Now, there's different types of filters. Now, we're not going to go into all the mathematics of filters. That's an entire class. But if you suffice it to say, there's something called a low-pass filter, which is exactly what that is. You cut off at the highest frequency, and then you then keep everything below that as far as frequency domain is considered. There's the other opposite of that is a high pass. You pass all the high frequencies. A band pass is most common in a lot of areas where you don't want a large DC offset or you don't want low noise signals. And there's a specific band that you expect the frequencies to be in. So that's what we call a band pass. And it looks like that little curve. It looks like a hump. The opposite of that is what we call a band stop. So maybe there's a certain area that you don't want to have. There's another version called a notch filter, where you cut out specific frequencies and then you keep the frequencies outside of those. And you can follow up with another filter on top of those. Then there's variations of those four. Those are the four basic ones, but like a low band pass is a variation of that. Band high pass is a variation of that. And a low band high pass is a variation of that, where you can see all the different variations. Now, for most signals, if you're trying to acquire a signal and digitize a signal, at minimum, you're going to at least need a low-pass filter. And the reason is you have to be able to define what that max frequency is. Why does that matter? Because it matters when we go to acquisition speed. So we'll talk about that when we get there. But if you don't have a defined max, then you really are going to get all sorts of anomalies in your signal. You'll get repeats, you'll get harmonics, you'll get all sorts of things that look like fake phantom signal if you don't clearly define what that maximum frequency is. So that's why in any basic system, at minimum, you're going to have a low pass. Really common, you'll have a band pass, which can be a combination of a low pass and a high pass. And then other variations are for very specific reasons. Other ways that you can reduce noise are what we call signal averaging. So this is where you take n repeated measurements, and if noise, truly random noise, is coming through, as you average repeat signals, that random noise will go down and go down and go down. Now, this only works if you have a signal that's fairly static that you're going to repeat over and over again, or that you can initiate the signal and evoke a response that you can repeat over and over again. You can line them up. They do this in very low-level signals. For example, in some areas in X-rays, they'll do some of this. They do it in neural signals where the signal is very, very tiny, but it's an evoked potential, so they can trigger a signal that they can then measure. So it's an evoked response. So then they'll hit that over and over again. And then as they get more and more measurements, the signal improvement is equal to the square root of n. So if you get four signals, you'll get twice the SNR improvement, signal noise ratio improvement, which means your signal gets boosted by two. Okay, you can also add and remove background with some of these things. So these are different ways to do it. So for example, if you have a system that you're trying to interrogate, but light is noise for you, you can actually have something that has the light plus the signal that you're looking for, and have another sensor that you're picking up just the background light, and you can subtract that out. That's another way to get rid of lots of other noise. Other things, you can add something that's a contrast agent, where it boosts the signal of what you're looking for relative to the background. So that's a little bit different technique to do that. Now, in real time, digital filtering is a little bit harder. It's better for post-processing, but there are systems that if the signal that you're looking at is slow enough, that you can actually do some digital processing real time. If it's a really fast signal, it becomes much harder. You either probably want to do it in hardware itself or do a lot of post-processing as well. There's lots of different types of post-processing software and toolboxes that are out there that you can use. LabVIEW is a common one. MATLAB's another one. Embedded processing is something where, particularly if you can get like an FPGA, and in real extreme situations, you can do ASICs, application-specific integrated circuits, to design a processing in the hardware that's super fast. And you've seen that where they've taken things that were large systems to process, say, like an EEG signal, and they've broken it down all the way down into a chip now. So pretty impressive stuff. So basic filters, for those of you who have an electrical engineering background or electrical sensor background, this is like old school for you. For others who have never seen it before, I'm just giving you a little bit of a highlight of what these look like and what the equations look like. I'm not asking you to derive these equations. That's not the point of this class. But be familiar with what these things look like. There's actually circuits you can build to do all these passive, or all these active filters that we talked about. They're active because they all require op amps. That's what this triangle is. It's an op amp that requires power to do this operation. In addition to that, you basically have capacitors, which is the CF or the CI in both these cases, and then two resistors. There's an input resistor and then the feedback resistor. The feedback is the one going from the back end all the way back to the front end. And based upon how you configure these things, you can generate a low-pass filter or a high-pass filter. And this is the very basic, easiest level of doing these things with an active way. You can actually cut down about 3 decibels at the point of frequency, the cutoff frequency. Now, again, this is the cutoff frequency. So if it's a low-pass filter, the cutoff frequency should be that maximum frequency that we want to allow through. On the other side, the high-pass filter, a cutoff frequency is the low-end cutoff that you're allowing everything above. So that's why it's called a cutoff on the low-end. And that's what the TAOs give you. If you notice in the low-pass, it's whatever that feedback resistor is times the capacitor, the feedback capacitor. If we're talking about a high-pass filter, it's the input resistor times the input capacitor. So it's really those types of things. And then the amount of amplification you get is what we call gain. And this is gain of the overall signal. So if we're, let's say if we're acquiring a 1 volt signal, but we want to increase it to 10 volts max. So if our max we think is going to be 1 volt and we want to increase it to 10, we actually want to amplify it 10 times to get a larger signal. Because again, we're trying to get that signal to just about match that gate of what we want to come in. That's what the equations above where it says the V out over V in. It's the voltage out over the input voltage that comes in. And if you notice, it's related to the ratio of the resistors. In the left-hand side, this actually inverts the signal. So it's a negative RF over RI. Now it's also dynamic based upon frequency. But if you're looking for just the baseline, like if we assume a DC signal, for example, then we can kind of ignore that. And just for estimation calculations, we say, well, at a DC level, it's going to be negative RF over RI. And when we consider it static, that's going to be the amplification. And that's what you use to estimate practically when you're going in through it. When you get in a dynamic sense, then it's going to be all over the place based upon the angular frequency omega. So, but when you're designing, that's the way you design a system. All right. Now there's also a second order bandpass filter. If you notice, this looks like a little bit of both of them. So it has both feedback resistor and capacitors and also input resistor and capacitors. And in this case, you get 2 cutoff frequencies. The low pass cutoff has to do with the 1/2 pi RFCF, the feedback system. The high pass cutoff, for like the high pass thing, just like the high pass filter, is 1/2 pi the input resistor times the input capacitor. So it's basically in one, it's a second order system because we have 2 capacitors. But it gets you kind of the same place all in one chip. So it's another way to do that. Now the gain on this then is still the static gain is RF over RI. It's the negative. So remember, it inverts the signal. So you'll have to reinvert that later after the fact. That gives you some sense of some filtering. There's a lot more advanced filtering that you can go into. Again, we used to teach a whole class on that. You get to instrumentation op amps and differential amplifiers, all sorts of interesting things that you can do, things to subtract offsets and that stuff. So the next stage, once you have your signal that's now converted electrically into the scale, and it's typically into a voltage that you want, now we see what we want to do with it. Now, these again are different types of amplifiers where we're just trying to change the scale. We're not worried about the frequency so much anymore. So there's a single end amplifier. Again, it's related to V out is equal to negative VI, RF over RI. That's kind of the same thing we saw before. And in reality, you could use one of those filters to do the same thing. It not only does this piece of the amplifying, but it also does the cutoff frequency as well. So typically you won't see this by itself unless somebody needs to add this after they've already done the cutoff frequency. There's a summing amplifier, like if you have some adjustment and need to add values. So it's summing, so it can subtract offset voltage. So if we have some major offset that is really noise for us, we can use something like this to subtract that out. Then there's differential amplifiers. This is where it will subtract what we call common mode noise. And so they call it here, where we're subtracting common mode rejection ratio, is how do we subtract out that? Now, what does that mean? Sometimes when you're taking a measurement, you'll have noise that happens at each point, and you need to measure the difference between two points, right? And that's typically on a floating, what they call a floating signal, something that's not grounded. That can happen when you're measuring something on the body, that can measure, or something that's not touching ground. And so you take measurements at two different places, and you want to know the difference between those two. So that's exactly what it is, differential. So you actually get the difference between V4 minus V3. And then it gives you the gain based upon that. And also, you can calculate something called the common mode rejection ratio in units of decibels, and it shows you with the gain what that looks like. It's 20 times the log base 10 of the gain of the system over the common mode gain. Meaning if you put the same signal at V3 and V4, what does that look like? And so that becomes the denominator. Instrumentation amplifier, again, I mentioned that before. This is where essentially you take a differential amplifier and you plug it right into this front circuit where you have two more amplifiers that subtract from each other. So it's basically all these things put together. It's used oftentimes when you have really low signals, but there are also floating signals, so where you need that subtraction, but you need more gain. And so you actually get the effect of gain not only on the second circuit, the R4 divided by R3, but also this first circuit, where you get a ratio of R2 over R1. And it ultimately turns out oftentimes that they'll fix a lot of these other components, R4, R3, R2, and sometimes they'll float R1 to make it adjustable so that you can, with one resistor, change the gain of the whole thing. Some of the benefits of this, it has even a greater rejection of common mode noise, an increased gain because now you've got more amplifiers to add gain to the system, and a very high output impedance, which means it helps when you're trying to actually take a measurement where you're not, by adding something that's measuring, changing the actual measurement, so which is a deeper conversation. So everything we've talked about up to now is really scaling up the signal, right? Making it bigger. The other thing sometimes you have to worry about is maybe a signal is too big, you know, or has too much current. And in those cases, you have to scale things down, which is opposite. Now, this is like if you're trying to measure power lines or you're trying to measure signals like out of a defibrillator or something that is meant to pump a lot of juice, you know, into somebody. So, but you can't measure that because it'll blow up your measurement system. You know, if you send all that current in, it's just going to fry your circuits. So you don't want that. So there's lots of different ways to do that. It really depends upon the application. A typical inductive solution is having step-down transformers, which is kind of beyond the scope of this class. But really, you'll have a transformer set with inductance and have one that will take that can take the full current moving through, and then you'll have a step-down system, and via inductance, you will design it so that it's down within the range that you need at a much lower current. So, and these are things that the cases that you look at, again, high voltages, like you're trying to measure electrical grid, solar output, and there's a lot of devices that already have these types of circuits built in them to be able to protect the measurement devices as well. They're actually designed for these types of things. So, and again, be very careful with that unless you know what you're doing, or you have a certified technician or somebody who knows what they're doing with that. Anyway, there's also safety regulations on how you do these things in electrical safety practices. So even the types of measurement devices that you would use for this, you want to make sure that they've been certified as far as how they work. Now, a different way of amplification is if instead of an electrical signal, let's say we have a signal that's not electrical, that's still optical. Now, optics are a little bit interesting because they're a little bit different in that you have to eventually convert them to electrical, but sometimes you can do things like amplify the optical signal before you can turn them electrically. Why is that? Well, for example, in a photomultiplier tube, this is one of the few types of things that can actually pick up single photons. And a photon isn't enough by itself to trigger enough electrons to get an electrical signal, because it's a very, very small effect. So you need something to amplify those photons into electrons. So you basically have this circuit in a photomultiplier tube to be able to increase the signal and convert monochromatic. They actually have different versions for different lights, so you can actually do it polychromatic later, into electric signal. And that's for really, really low-end signals. Another way you can do it is you increase an exposure time. Like if you have something more like a camera, like a CMOS camera array, or an older CCD. CMOS cameras are kind of the newer thing. They're faster than CCDs, which we have used before. They have better sensitivity, and they can convert polychromatic light into digital signals. And by having them in an array, instead of just having a one-to-one, you can actually produce an organized set of information that gives you a picture, which is very different than a photomultiplier tube can't. It can just amplify a signal. That's all it knows, is its signal. So it's a 1D, where the CMOS camera array is 2D plus amplitude. The other thing you can do is increase your exposure area, which is like what we do with satellites. Or we do with telescopes in space. We get a much larger area, a dish, or if you're looking at the Webb telescope, we have all these panels that create an effective large area, and that gives us more signal and more sensitivity. So in optics, there's lots of interesting new ways that we're amplifying those signals. A little bit of the difference between CCDs versus CMOS cameras, because both of them are still on the market. CCD has a pixel layout, and it actually outputs an analog signal that then gets amplified with these different addresses, and it kind of scans through all of these pixels. A CMOS pixel circuit is a little bit different. Then it digitizes at each pixel itself, so that what comes out is a digital signal. And so in that way, they can gate the system to actually be even faster. And so here's a little bit of comparison that you can see on this table here. Look it over. There's different things that CCDs are good for versus CMOS. Like, you get a little bit more dynamic range with some of the CCDs, although depending upon the tech these days, it's changing very rapidly. They both have pretty good responsivities. CMOS actually can go into higher ranges. The pixel signal is a voltage in a CMOS versus an electron packet in a CCD. Costs are about the same. Complexities are, roughly the same. The one thing about CMOS, which is also helpful, is actually has lower power consumption. So that's a big thing. And they both have range of resolutions that are still comparable to each other. All right. So that's the different thing about scaling a signal, both whether we're talking about electrical signals or optical signals. Now we want to convert that signal into digital data. What does that look like? Well, that requires an analog to digital conversion. And so happens that they have chips that do this, which is wonderful for us. And there's lots of different implementations, again, outside of the scope of this class. There's not just one way to convert an analog signal to a digital signal. But we usually put these into the data acquisition boards, so this is already in there. And like the data acquisition boards that we're using in this class, those chips are actually in those systems so that we can convert. Now, there's a couple things that we want to make sure that we know. One is, what's the resolution range for our chip? Is it a 12-bit? That's kind of how they were 20 years ago. 16-bit, that became more common later. Or 24-bit, and then you could go higher. However, the higher you go, the more memory it's going to take to be able to acquire that. So what does this give you? This gives you, if you think about it, the bits give you, if you think of the bottom level of a signal to the top level of a signal, it gives you the number of steps. So think of a staircase, and each part of a bit, so a 12-bit gives you 2 to the 12, or I think it's 4,096 steps between the bottom and the top. 16-bit gives you 2 to the 16. 24-bit gives you 2 to the 24. So it gives you way more steps, and so therefore it affects the resolution or how cleanly you can see a signal going from the top of your scale to the, or sorry, from the bottom of your scale to the top of your scale. And so if you're looking at a signal between negative 1 volt and a positive volt, that tells you how many steps that you can scale that to, or between negative 10 volts and positive 10 volts, which is typically the max that you see in most data acquisition systems. Now, a reference voltage that they excite these chips with typically is between 5 to 15 volts. It probably depends upon, you know, what scale you want to go up to. If you want something that's going to be, you know, a higher voltage out, you got to have a higher voltage in, obviously. The VIN range typically, again, max is plus or minus 10 volts. And we always look at resolution as the least significant bit voltage. So remember when I tell you about the scale, about the bottom end and the top end, one stair step is what we call the least significant bit, right? So it's the V reference minus the VSS divided by 2 to the number of bits. And so N is those number of bits. And VSS typically is 0. So usually you can say it's the V reference, whatever we have there, if it's 5, 10, or 15 volts, divided by 2 to the N. And that tells us the actual smallest increment that we can actually detect in our digital system. If we have something smaller than the least significant bit, like if there's a little bit of a change in our analog signal before that, we cannot pick that up. Because the best we can do is go from 0 to the least significant bit voltage. And anything smaller than that, we can't see it. Anything greater than that, we can see it. So it's kind of this balance of wanting as much resolution as necessary, but for cost-wise, because again, if you get a 24-bit conversion system, it's going to cost you more. All right, the other thing that we have to consider is the sampling rate, and this is what has to do with the maximum frequency. So how fast can we take samples with this analog-to-digital conversion? So it really depends upon the technology that you're using. Some things can go extraordinarily fast, can go into gigahertz. Some things even faster than that when you're trying to look in the radio frequencies. Those things are very expensive because they have to acquire super, super quickly to be able to acquire those signals when you're looking at telecom signals, things like that. But if you're using slower systems, it's not a bigger deal. So it actually doesn't cost as much. So for example, let's say we can sample at 20 kilohertz, which is basically we can sample 20,000 points a second. That's how fast we can pull data off and turn it from analog into a digital binary bit, or sorry, binary output. Then our sampling frequency is going to be at least twice that. Now we'll get to that. I'm kind of jumping ahead here. So, but our hertz then tells us 1 over the time per sample. So in that sense, if it's 20 kilohertz is the fastest sampling rate we have, really that tells us it's going to take us 50 microseconds for us to sample one data point. So that tells us how fast we're picking up a data point. And that's super fast, but there's things that are way faster than that. So here's the other component for sampling. This is probably one of the most important components. It's called the Nyquist-Shannon sampling theorem. I also put in a rule of thumb here because the sampling theorem is good for certain specific types of signals, but then I'm going to show you why we use the rule of thumb as well. So this tells us the minimum sampling rate, or FS, the sampling rate, that it needs to be at least twice as fast as the maximum frequency. Now again, we were talking about maximum frequency before. Why is that important? Because it's the maximum frequency that we determine by our filtering. Remember, we want to at least have a low-pass filter. We're going to determine what that top frequency is that we're allowing through. To digitize it correctly and not get aliasing, which gives us phantom signals, which makes it look like that there's frequencies there that are not actually there because they get back reflected from higher frequencies to lower. We have to take that maximum frequency and we have to double the rate. The reason is, by this theorem, is that if you do not do that, you are not picking up the frequency adequately. You're not sampling fast enough to be able to detect an actual frequency happening. And so you get a scenario where, like in the first picture, you may think that your sampling is actually quite slower than what the red line of what actually is happening is. And so you get these dots that are giving you an inaccurate picture of what's actually going on. So you really need to be at least twice as fast. Now, that's great because that's the minimum. Now that works for sinusoidal signals or very simple signals that are very well defined like that. It does not work very well for natural or complex signals. So for that reason, particularly like we were dealing with biological signals for like ECGs that have complex patterns and forms. So you want to actually sample even faster so that you get enough sampling points that you can accurately recreate what those frequencies are. So we recommend 5 to 10 times. Again, it's based upon how fast can you go. More sampling is better because with oversampling, you can actually do things like averaging and stuff like that if you get the chance and you can clean up your signal digitally. But you don't always have that luxury. But we generally do a rule of 5 to 10 times the highest frequency than you expect to have come in. The point of this is it preserves not only that frequency component of the signal, but you also can preserve the time series or the pattern of the signal that you may need to look for. And it just depends upon the analysis that you want to do after the fact. So keep that in mind. The next piece is rescaling the data. So now we're at a point where we've got the data stored in a system. Now, it's acquired, and then we usually store it into some type of data file. It could be a binary data file, which is like really low memory, really fast, not readable by a human being. You have to have a way to decode it and or a header. A very common one is actually .csv files, which are a precursor to something that you can pull into a spreadsheet like Excel. That's very common. Or into a database, right, that you recover then later on through SQL or something. But for when you're talking about the initial raw data, usually it's in files that are fairly close, fairly local, or on the network that the system is on. So you can store the data there, and then you have another program that might pull things off of that data for post-processing. So rescaling, oftentimes, it can be done prior to storage, but once you actually have the data being pulled into a computer program, that's when you can start your rescaling. You can do it live while it's actually gathering data, if the data you're gathering is slow enough. Because if you think about this, an operating system, say you're working on a Windows computer, or you're working actually almost any computer, about the fastest you can get still is about one millisecond turnaround time. So, which is really fast, but not if you're talking about something that's going down to microseconds. So that's where you may need to use the data acquisition buffer, where you can load in whole bunches of data, process a whole bunch of data, and then store it. So the rescaling can happen before storage. It can happen after it's been stored and doing post-processing. You can do it either way. So what does rescaling look like? It depends, as with a lot of these answers, right? It depends on what we're doing. So for example, if simply we have a sensor that has a linear response, or we're in that linear response range, then it's really easy. We know it's just a line, and there's a relationship between the voltage coming out and the actual measurement that I'm interested in. So there's the output units of measure that I want. It's going to be equal to the sensitivity which is kind of the gain, times the digitized signal voltage plus the offset. So in that case, it's kind of reversing everything around. We're solving for X in that case. So here they're showing kind of the equation of Y equals MX plus B divided by the gain. So because the gain is something that we used before. A different sensor data sheet will tell you how to then recreate or what type of rescaling equation you should use. Sometimes it'll be just a paper sheet that comes in with the sensors. Sometimes they'll direct you to their website, say, here's what it is. And oftentimes, if it's very specific sensors, they'll have a calibration specific to that sensor itself, which sometimes you have to pay attention to because some things can get out of calibration. So some sensors require, for example, like pH sensors, you have to recalibrate them every so often because they drift over time, just because the sensor starts getting worn. Just like anything gets worn, like your brakes get worn in your car. Sensors also wear down over time and things can shift. And so you have to make sure you recalibrate to make sure it's actually giving you accurate results. So here's an example on sensitivity for measuring pressure. So here they're saying, let's say the little sheet that we have with our sensor says for every millimeter of mercury, which is a pressure measurement, we get 1 millimeter of mercury for about every 2 millivolts. And that's with a bias voltage. So that basically we had to put a bias voltage across the system so that it actually could give us a signal at all, which that bias signal was 0.7 millivolts. So the question is then, what is the pressure rescale equation if we acquire the voltage, or if we acquire a voltage is 5 volts, and we've given it a gain of 10x, meaning we've amplified it 10 times. So basically we can plug this in. We have the output, because again, we basically took and reversed everything so that the Y now is what the input really was. And so if you notice, we take the sensitivity, the millimeter of mercury over 2 millivolts, times how many volts that we had, which was the 5 volts, divided by our gain, which is 10. Now gain, being in decibels, is essentially unitless in this case, so you don't have to carry the unit there. And the offset was 0.7 millivolts, which was our offset, but we also have to divide that by the gain too. So make sure that you account for that. And then that gives us, if you cancel out all the voltages, you get just units of millimeters mercury. So we get roughly 250 millimeters mercury. Now there's also nonlinear sensors, which we talked about, particularly like in temperature and some of the thermistors and things like that. They may have nonlinear scales. So depending upon the type, they'll give you it with the sensor, but you may want to know which type of sensors give you linear outputs versus nonlinear outputs. So these equations are really specific to the sensor type. And so this one, it shows you this general beta parameter equation. And so it's 1 over the temperature is equal 1 over T naught, which is the reference temperature. Then we have the beta, which is a constant that's given that's based upon the sensor itself. And then the log of the RT over RO. And that's basically the two resistors in the system. And then we look at the voltage divider circuit, and so that gives us what our Vout is. And essentially, it turns out that if you replace the resistances with the voltage equations, then you basically put the Vs over Vo minus 1 instead of the RT over RO, and it gives you those types of things. This is from Jamico. They actually make different types of sensors, temperature sensors being one of them. And this is one way you do it. Now you'd have to resolve that equation for putting temperature in the numerator. But what a lot of people do is they'll solve the whole thing for 1 over TK and then just invert the answer programmatically. That's a little bit easier to do. Thermocouples, again, they may have really complex equation. They use inverse polynomial coefficients. Again, you'll have to look at the specific type of temperature sensors and what they are. So in this case, it's the sum of a whole bunch of constants with different energy levels. So if E is the voltage in millivolts and DI is the coefficient for the ith term of the inverse function, you really get this summation of these systems that is a nonlinear polynomial. So if we were looking at, for example, if you went and looked up the N-type thermocouple that's ranged for 0 to 600 degrees C, and you measured an EMF of 18.788 millivolts, how do you calculate the actual temperature? So you actually, like, I went to the NIST.gov tables, and that's the National Institute of Standards. And this is where you actually get all of the constants that you see down in the base equation. And so if you sum all those up, you get a zero term, then you get the constant 38.68960 times E, which we were given 18.788 millivolts. And make sure that you do the voltages right, that you are talking about millivolts. And then it's minus the next term with E squared, then it's plus the next term, E to the cubed, then it's minus the next term, E to the fourth, and so on. And you can go all the way to the E to the seventh. Now, a lot of people will just estimate, because maybe they don't need it that accurate, maybe they'll just go to the second term, where it's the quadratic, and just stop at the E to two, E to the E squared term, because that's enough accuracy for them. But other people may need things that are way more accurate, because they're going across a broad range, so then they need to go to the E3 or the E4. If you go the full gamut, you go all the way to E7. If you're trying to do this manually, this would take a long time to do. But if you put it in an algorithm, and LabVIEW actually has some of these tables built in, like if you tell it that it's a temperature sensor and you tell it the type of temperature sensor it's in, they have these things built in algorithmically to do these calculations and these scaling conversions for you, which is hugely powerful, because if you do that ahead of time, particularly with temperature, you can, because temperature typically moves pretty slow. Then you don't store the data in the EMF voltage, you store the data in temperature directly, and you don't have to monkey with this. So you have this equation running just as fast as your acquisition, and it's part of your analysis. So that's the type of decision making that you have to have when you're looking at when you're converting the data. When does it make the most sense to convert the data? So it saves you time, saves you work. And if you can let the program do the hard and heavy lifting for you, why not? So it's a lot easier than trying to do any of this manually or even in a spreadsheet. Now, it doesn't matter if we're talking about a small system where you're just doing a one-off one measurement, which is some of the things we'll probably be doing in this class, versus if you're going to try to do something massive like the Large Hadron Collider. All of these fundamentals are the same. It does not matter. What matters is to make sure that you understand the process so that regardless, whatever systems you face, it doesn't matter what technologies you're using, you know, what manufacturing line you've got going on, you know, who's doing it, it doesn't really matter. What matters is making sure that you understand the process of going through understanding your signal, making sure it's properly filtered, making sure you can scale it properly so you don't blow up your data acquisition system, convert that signal to data, and rescale the data. Now, rescale could come while you're converting the data. If it's slow, like temperature, which we just talked about, or rescaling could come after post-process. It just depends upon the situation. So you have to understand that. So there's some decision-making on where you're going to do things digitally. And that's really it. When you think about it, once you have this system down, you can make a data acquisition system for any type of system, whether you're in manufacturing, whether you're in healthcare, whether you're in physics, whether you're in, you know, optics, it really doesn't matter. And that's the beauty of it, because once you understand how you convert physical data into your digital data, now you know how all that stuff gets there and where a lot of these databases that have physical data have gone through to get there. So it's important to understand and appreciate all the work that's come into getting data into either a database or, you know, spreadsheets or however that data is being stored. All right. With that, I hope you enjoyed that. I know it's about 50 minutes, but thank you so much, and I'll see you next time.